Hi, John here. This video is a bit of a bumper one actually, because I'm going to cover 3 months worth of solar energy and home energy updates. So the months of July, August, and September. So I'm a bit behind. So apologies if you've been waiting. I think I might, going forward, do this as a normal thing every quarterly, because I'm struggling to keep on top of the monthly ones with all the other things that are going on. So let me know your thoughts in the comments, whether you prefer monthly or quarterly or not at all. Up on screen at the moment is our setup. You'll notice that, well, you may not notice, but I'll point it out to you. There are a couple of new things in the bottom right-hand corner. We've got the heat pump listed and the Valent Unistore hot water cylinder. Everything else is as was. So I'm going to give you an update on the two cars as well, the Model 3 and the Zoe, as well as our wind turbine, part of the wind farm that we're in. In fact, well, let's start with that, shall we? To date, since March 2022, we have accumulated in savings £817.19. And you can see the last 3 months there. July was bumper, like really windy. So £117.19 for the month, credited to our Octopus Energy account. And August and September were also very good as well. How that equates to our overall savings and ownership. So here is our ownership summary in terms of the capacity that we have. So we've in Cragthafr, we have 1,532 kilowatts. Kirkhill, which is coming online the sort of quarter one in 2024, we've got almost twice that, so just under twice. And the investment we've made in Cragthafr is £2,602. And I worked out that we're so far 18 months in, we're on a 31% return on our investment, which I'm very pleased with actually. As we've got 25 years to run on that, that should look good. I suspect that will drop back next year. We won't have the same bumper benefits as we have had this year in terms of the price per kilowatt hour. But anyway, still good stuff. So I'm really pleased I've done it. Another update is the website. So we've now got a live monitor. It's still in beta version, but we've got a live monitor of the turbine. So we can see the wind speed, its direction, the blade angle, and its rotation in revs per minute. And then underneath the chart, you can change the scale of it to daily, weekly, monthly, yearly, and then also look at the electricity generation, savings, and average wind speed. That's really good actually to have a look at. So there's some really good days. For instance, there in September, remember September was a bumper month, 29 miles per hour top wind speed, which works out we earned £9.33 on that day on the 19th of September. So if there's any questions on the Ripple side of things, drop them into the comments and I will pick them up. Moving on to solar, so the last 3 months you can see there, July, August, and September, all roughly about the same. Nothing really to pick out as a highlight there. They were fairly good months. I think September was a little bit duller than expected and typically, but it's certainly better than the year before. But in the year before we were one solar array down, so it's always going to look a lot better. Looking at the breakdown across the three months over the two arrays. And again, interesting. I was looking at July and September. If you have a look at the 2.34 array, the top array, it's very, very similar, 241 versus 242 over those 2 months, July and September. Whereas there's sort of 50 kilowatt difference between the 4 kilowatt array down at the bottom there, 461, 415. And I can't really see any reason for that. There was no discernible difference that I knew of. Yeah, I shall keep my eye on that. I don't think there's anything to worry about in terms of a panel being down or something, because the generation is, it looks okay. So we'll see. Keep an eye on it. This is the overall contribution to our self-power between the Powerwall and solar. Now again, you've got those 3 months. I'll leave you to have a look at that. You can see they're starting to decline as the solar days reduce in terms of the duration of the daylight. We also had a FIP payment come in, so that's quarter three, so up at the top there. So you're going off the scale, I have to increase the scale. So a very good quarter across those 3 months. And we've got one more payment to go at the end of December, and that'll be our year end. So our running total for the year in 2023 at the moment is 2,269, probably another £500 on top of that. So 2,700. So again, that should be probably one of our best fit years to date. So a running total of 25,000 will take us to 27,000, which is good. And as I said previously, all of that gets ploughed back into the house in terms of updating our systems. A lot of the money's gone into the new heat pump. These are the 3 months over the years, over the previous years. So going back to July, back to 2012, fairly even July there. August was pretty good for us. And then September, again, ignore 2022 because we will want to rate down. You see that sort of in keeping with previous years. Putting those three together show a different view of the same data set. I also then had a poke about in Home Assistant, looking at the energy dashboard. So this is the month of July that you're looking at. The top chart graph is showing all the uses. It's a bit cumbersome if you're looking at it in this sort of format on a month. It's better to look at it in a day by day or week by week. But I've hovered over the legend there on one of the bars, so you can see the green is consume battery, consume solar, and so on down that list. And then below it in the daily solar production. And over on the right-hand side, you've got the distribution chart. The energy distribution is the totals for each one of those items, so solar, home, battery, and grid for that month. And then underneath, net consumption from the grid, self-consumption, blah, 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 self-sufficiency, and low carbon. So that's July. If we move that into August, you'll notice in August, the last three, 29th, 30th, and 31st, that little white dotted line and the solar production, that's the forecasting coming back in. It was offline for a while because they rewrote the code on it. So I believe that, but you can see it's fairly accurate, the forecasting. It tends to under forecast rather than over forecast, which is always a good thing. So that's Home Assistant, looking at the 3 months. You might want to see that. That's the year to date for 2023. And then back to my normal Excel charts. So this is the average daily home usage and average daily grid pull. You'll see that's starting to increase again now as we move into the autumn. This is what we sent to the grid. A couple of months there in August and September where we sent quite a bit, really. I've said before, and I'll just reiterate, we don't have an export tariff. We really concentrate on using what we generate rather than exporting. There's no benefit to us in having an export tariff at the moment because we don't really export enough. If you go back, if you look at the last sort of 2 years, we haven't exported very much at all. Just the odd month where it's gone a bit jillally, but generally it's not a big amount over the course of the year. This is from the grid for, again, July, August, September. And if you want to pause these and have a look in a little more detail, you can do. Please feel free. This is the EDI. Now, the EDI is sort of not decommissioned per se, but it's being used less and less now. Because we have the heat pump, it's far more efficient to use the heat pump to generate our domestic hot water. That's running at a COP of sort of 3.5. So for every one unit of energy or electricity, we can generate 3.5 units of heat, whereas the EDI will only ever do 1-to-1. So 1 unit of electricity will generate 1 unit of heat. We are using it a bit if we've got loads of excess solar and I need to dump it somewhere. So I will dump it into the hot water storage tank rather than, you know, like the cars are full, they will be the first priority, battery second priority, and then, you know, if there's nothing else that we can use the electricity for, run a kiln or something like that, washing machine, dishwasher, you know the score, I'll heat the hot water with it. So it's not redundant, but it's being used less and less So much so that even September I forgot to record the month-end figure. Cars, fairly straightforward, so I'm not going to dwell on that. Our gas meter was removed on the 16th of September. I'm just waiting for the final bill from Octopus Energy. That will be sort of 12 days, should be. And then that's us done with gas, so no more gas bills. And this is electricity, which we will see increasing now as we're going off gas and using all electric. This is up to 4th of October, so the last 3 or 4 months there you can have a scan at. We've moved on to Octopus Intelligent, so 7.14 off peak from 11:30 to 5:30, and then 28 pence at all other times, with additional slots available as well if we need to charge the car. And I found Octopus Intelligent working very well for us. We're on the Zappy 1, version 1. Tesla Model 3 is absolutely fine. Zoe, not absolutely fine, doesn't work. But if I need to schedule the Zoe, then I will schedule it in the car and use the 11:30 to 5:30 slot. But as it only holds 20 kilowatts, generally we can charge that from excess solar. A very quick summary there in terms of the last 3 months. So there's a lot of detail I've probably skipped and gone over. So if there's any questions, then do drop into the comments and I will pick those up. All right. Thanks for watching, listening, and I'll see you on the next video. Take care. Bye.